Good morning. I hope you're well. So today we are going to continue with our lesson in computer graphics. And we are going to be discussing lesson 6, that is on 3D objects. We had a look at, in the previous lesson, we had a look at transformations, and where we discussed affine transformation, homogeneous coordinates, hierarchical transformation, transformation in OpenGL, and we saw how the primitives and the functions used in OpenGL to implement transformations. And of course, in the previous lesson 4, we had looked at curves. So I would like to say at this point that we had largely dealt with 2D when you're dealing with curves, when you're dealing with transformations, and in our discussion we had even seen the mathematical manipulation of the rotated vectors, points on the XY coordinate and Cartesian plane, and also on the entire transformation and the both vector and matrix algebra, the application in transformations. And we had actually seen the number of translations that the type of translations which are there. Excuse me. We had mentioned some of the affine transformation, like for instance translation, scale, shear, which are represented by the graphics you're seeing here. Translation, the black image is the original image. The one that appears in blue is the translation in this case. The scale appears in blue. Scale just means enlarging or making it smaller. Shear, of course, you can see the impact there. And then we have rotation. We even have another one probably that we did not discuss, which is reflection. But I think with these four, and primarily those are affine transformations, we look at how they are implemented in 3D. And we mentioned about translation, rotation and scaling. And we saw that we have the function GL translate function, which takes TX, TY, and TZ. In this case, because you're doing translation of in 2D, then we have TX and TY as the translation coordinates. Then rotation, we mentioned about rotation around a certain angle. So we have, in this case, A is the angle, and we get the cosine of it and the sine of it. We do the arithmetics, and that gives us the value by which our graphic is going to rotate. Then we have, and we have of course the function that is used here for rotation, where we specify the coordinates X, Y, and Z. Let's say the point, in this case, is going to be X and Y because we only have two. And then we have A, the angle of rotation. This informs, these parameters are adequate for the rotate function in the graphics library to be implemented. Then scaling, which refers to basically zooming in and out, is implemented in form of a scaling factors, which a scaling factor along the x-axis and along the y-axis. So we have scaling factor for x, scaling factor for y, and the function, the scale function in the graphics library, is provided with the values, three values for the scaling factor, float. For the scaling factor along the x-axis, along the y-axis, and the z-axis. We are limited ourselves to x and y, and therefore that tells you that already these functions can be used for three dimension, which is actually the case. If we want to use these transformations in one instance, then we, in other words, combine them, then they follow the order translate, rotate, and scale. Now, having learned that in the previous lesson, in today's lesson I would like us to look at 3D objects. Take note that when we talk of 3D, it means that you're adding the z-axis. It's as simple as that. When it comes to the interpretation within the Cartesian plane, we're adding the z-axis. When it comes to the matrices, where we had 3x3, we're going to have 4x4, and you're going to see those two instances. But most important, already we have laid a base for computer graphics. When you are discussing 2D, we have done examples even for curves, we implemented using WebGL. It is not that we cannot implement even when it comes to transformations and, you know, 3D objects, but given the time factor and having introduced this base, we'll try our best to cover within the time limits we have. And in this case, we just need to get the concepts for 3D objects. We have a number of concepts here to just peruse through and get to have to appreciate the concepts of surface representation, planes, surface tangents and normals, parametric surfaces, affine transformations, spherical coordinates, nonlinear transformations, representing triangle meshes, and generating triangle meshes, and then of course we can have the usual discussion session. I'll also probably briefly take us through a sample illustration of how that the form it takes, this 3D transformations, the form it takes in form of matrix or vector algebra, so that you're able to appreciate all out from the basis we have come in lesson 2 of mathematics, the mathematical connection to the mathematical connection of computer graphics with respect to 3D transformations. So over now to the concepts that we need to internalize before we get into the mathematical manipulations. Surface representation, basically, as with 2D objects, we can represent 3D objects in parametric or implicit form. So we can, you know, there are also explicit forms of 3D surfaces sometimes, which are called height fields. Now the explicit, as you look at into this particular figure, which you're referring here as figure 6.1, the explicit parametric and implicit forms of a line are indicated there. The explicit form representing a line in form of y is equals mx plus c, as you know, this is a line that doesn't have any curve. This form is limited to straight line alone, and you can see it's represented in the above diagram. Explicit form y is equals mx plus c. So suppose we want to model a line, any line in our computer graphic system. An alternative way to do this is to use a parametric form, this form, where you have a point S made up of x, which indicates the starting point, x0, and of course x1, which is the vector in the positive direction of the line. We have introduced the dummy parameter S as a mechanism of iterating along the line. Given an S, we obtain a point PS, some distance along the line, and you can use, when S is 0, we are the starting of the line. So now, with this parametric form, then we see that when positive values of S move us, positive values of S will move us along the line, and negative, forward along the line, and negative values will move us backward. If you go back to this figure, in other words, you're saying positive values like this one will move us forward along the line, and negative values will move backward along the line. That is very easy to interpret within the Cartesian plane. So, by convention, we use P0 to denote the start of the space curve and P1 to denote the endpoint of the curve. That is, we increase S from 0 to 1 to move along the entire finite length of the curve. And you can generalize this concept to produce curve trajectories, so that if, for instance, we consider PS as a position of a particle flying through space and S as analogous to time, then X0 is the starting position of the particle and X1 is the velocity of the particle. We can add a term X2 for the relation as shown here, to yield a quadratic curve. We can continue adding terms to any order. I mean, this is what you're referring to as order. This is what makes it quadratic. We can take it to a polynomial of order 3 and then we make it cube. Then and so on and so forth. But for purposes of understanding, beyond quadratic, it becomes a little bit difficult for us to interpret. Although in practice, it's unusual for computer graphics to use anything above, the cubic curves, because when it goes beyond that, it becomes hard for us to understand things which are beyond the third dimension. The final representation of space curve that we look at is the implicit form. In the implicit form, we express the equation of a curve as a function of all its coordinates equal to a constant, often 0, e.g. in 2D we have the function xy, a function of xy which are coordinates in the Cartesian plane, that is in 2D, equated to 0. We can reach the implicit form of 2D line easily from the parametric form by writing out the x and y components of the equation. Here we write x0, y0, and x1 is equals u, v, in which case this now happens to be the coordinates of x0 and x1 respectively. And then of course now we can see the way we work out where x0 and y0, u and v are constant defining the line. We insert values for a point, given point x, y, and if the equation is satisfied, the left hand, you know, if the equation is satisfied, meaning the left hand is zero, we are at a point on the line if this is satisfied. As long as this is satisfied, we that point x, y is within the line. That's what it means. Furthermore, the term on the left hand side is positive if we are off the line, but on the side on one side of it, and negative if we are on the other side. This is because the left hand side evaluates the sine distance from the point xy to the nearest point on the line, and we can actually view that from what we have in this diagram here. So the implicit form, you get to see as explained in the content. And of course the parametric form, where we have the negative and the positive. As long as the fx y is fulfilled is equal to 0, then we can have all the points within this yielding this 0. And anything that deviates, if it's on the left side that deviates, then could be show a positive. But if it's yield 0, then we know that you're along this line. We'll expect that the implementation of that, I'll be demonstrating the implementation of that in 3D in matrices for a better understanding. For now, we go ahead with the concept of planes. When you're talking about planes, first of all, you know that two vectors that form an angle, which is not an angle. When you're talking of planes, you're referring to two vectors that form an angle which is not equal to 0 or more than 180 degrees. The plane spawned by two vectors is uniquely defined. As you can see, we have two vectors here. This means that if we know three points that are not on a line, the plane is uniquely defined. The plane's normal is defined by two vector cross products. So this vector, cross product of this vector, yields the plane normal. The normal, which is at a perpendicular angle to the two vectors. The general form of a plane, therefore, is ax plus by plus cz plus d is equal to 0. Is an advancement of y is equals mx plus c, where the vector abc is a plane's normal. Abc is a plane's normal. We will not prove, of course, we know the reasons for this. We use the right hand rule to calculate the normal, and I think we had done the part to do with cross products, and therefore we already appreciate that working out the cross product at this level would be kind of repetition. Since OpenGL separates between front and back on surfaces, it is important that we state normals in a systematic way. D can be found by inserting a point in the plane in the general plane equation. That is about the planes. The surface tangents are normals. Of course, when you talk of the surface normal, whenever you talk of the surface tangent, we are talking of if we have, let's say, a point P in a curve, the tangent will be the it will be the intersection direction. Will be basically the line that is we can say not really normal to that is normal to that point. So we say the tangent to a curve at point P is the instantaneous direction of the curve at point P. The tangent plane to a surface at point P is analogous. It is defined as a plane containing tangent vectors to all curves of the surface that go through point P. The normal line is a line that passes through and is perpendicular to the tangent plane at P and perpendicular to the surface at P. Of course, that's the normal line. And you can now see the tangent plane as a collection of all those tangents at point P. Now, I hope you can still remember tangent from our previous studies in mathematics. Parametric surfaces. A parametric surface is a surface that is in the Euclidean space, which is defined by the parametric equation. with two parameters. In other words, yeah, this parametric surface is a Euclidean space. Which space is defined by parametric equation with two parameters? We have already seen the parametric representation, which is a very general way to specify a surface, as well as the implicit representation of surfaces. Surfaces that occur in two of the main theorems, vector calculus, Stokes theorem, and divergence theorem, are encoded given a parametric form. We have seen how we give this surface a parametric form. But the main thing for us now, moving 3D, we shall think of it more in terms of the matrices and the vectors. The simplest type of parametric surfaces is given by the graph of functions of two variables. This one we yield what we referred in the beginning as a hot. We referred it to as a the representation of this functions. Function is a we call it the height field. It's kind of represented 2D as 3D height fields. I think we shall have a better illustration of it as we proceed to the next illustration we're going to see in form of matrices and vectors. A rational surface is a surface that admits parameterization by a rational function. A rational surface is an algebraic surface. Given an algebraic surface, it's commonly easier to decide if it is rational than to compute its rational parameterization if it exists. Surface of a revolution gives another important class of surfaces that can be easily parameterized. The straight circular cylinder of radius r about x axis has the following parametric representation. You of course specify the angle and the x along the x axis, the value, and then of course based on that angle now we can compute the rotation which creates the cylinder, the cosine value and the sine value, and the distance along the axis. It makes sense. In other words, if we have the x axis as measured in the Cartesian plane from 0 all the way, let's say x is 1, that becomes the radius. In other words, the angle of rotation now gives us the cylinder, cosine 0 and sine 0. 3D affine transformations, three-dimensional transformations which are used for many different purposes such as coordinate transform, shape modeling, animation and camera modeling, especially in animation. Now, which is something we ought to have covered differently, but in the interest of time then, I think we appreciate that 3D affine transformation are mostly used in the animation. If that doesn't mean we can also animate 2D by making them rotate around or something of the sort. Now, for translations, remember we had 2 points, we had 2 translation factors, Tx and Ty. Now, with 3D, we add another one, Tz. Scaling, we had 2 scaling factors, Xx and Sy, now we have Sz. Rotation, we had, of course, the angle, theta. Now we have, the it's kind of a matrix of angles, like what you're seeing here, which you're calling R. I think that's the easiest way to remind ourselves of 3D affine as compared to 2D, and of course those are the representations there. Spherical coordinate system is a coordinate system for 3-dimensional space where the position of a point is specified by 3 numbers, and the radial distance of that point from a fixed origin, its polar angle measured from a fixed zenith direction, and the azimuthal angle of its orthogonal projection on reference plane, which passes through the origin at the orthogonal to the zenith, measured from a fixed reference direction on that plane, can be seen as a 3-dimensional version of the polar coordinate system. As a matter of fact, 3-dimensional version of the polar coordinate. In matrices, this means you just add one more column or row to make it a 4x4 for purposes of easier manipulation. We have some non-linear transformation. We have dealt with linear transformation previously when you're talking about the 2D transformations, but that doesn't mean you can't have some linear non-linear transformation. When we talk of When you talk of aqua intransmission such as scaling and shear, we are then dealing with the most simplistic. But sometimes non-rigid. We have higher order deformations which include tapering, twisting and bedding. If you look at these two examples, we have a non-linear taper. You want to produce A and B. If A and B are constant, then you have a linear transformation of this point Q. But if A and B are functions, if they're functions, then what we have is a quadratic taper, which looks like this. So this is a nonlinear transformation, this is a linear transformation. Next, we look at representing triangle meshes. We mentioned about triangle meshes. A triangle mesh is often represented with a list of vertices, of course, that ought to be the case, and a list of triangle faces. Each vertex consists of three floating point values, that is x, y, and z positions. And a face consists of three indices of vertices in the vertex list. Representing a mesh this way reduces memory use. That we had mentioned when we were talking, and basically talking about the need for us to avoid the challenges that go with the triangle meshes, because if we allow every point to be represented as an independent, even rendering that on the screen, we consume too much memory and bring the issue of how to deal with hidden surfaces. So by ensuring that these vertices are not replicated, so that when they are shared, then we have the shared sharing reflected within the rendering. That way, we avoid the issue of hidden surfaces and of our production of unnecessary vertex. And representing a mesh this way reduces memory use. That's what they're saying, since each vertex needs to be stored once rather than once for every face it is on. And this gives connectivity information, since it is possible to determine which face share a common vertex. This can easily be extended to represent polygons with an arbitrary number of vertices. But any polygon can be decomposed into triangles. That's all I need to mention here, that these vertices that will not be visible doesn't mean that they're not going to be defined. Every vertex will be defined, literally. Because it becomes important when you're doing animation for this to be seen. Even the hidden surfaces now will be revealed. For instance, when you're rotating a cube. And that is important, therefore, to define every vertex. How do you generate triangle meshes? This the mesh generation is a practice of creating a mesh as a division of a continuous geometric space into discrete geometric and topological cells. Meshes are used for rendering to a computer screen and for physical simulations such as finite element analysis or computational fluid dynamics. Yeah, fluid dynamics is an interesting area in engineering. Mesh generation can be of assistance when it comes to those simulation of those fluid dynamics. I have mentioned that I would like us to just briefly look at how the transformations happen in 3D, having migrated from 2D, ourselves having migrated from 2D to 3D now. We define transformations that can be done in 3D, a position, which is basically called translation, size, which is scaling, orientation, which is rotation, and shape, which is shear. Of course, previously we worked with 2D, which is on the Cartesian plane, is represented by the X coordinate and the Y coordinate, and now we extend to 3D, which the Cartesian plane represents as X, Y, and Z. Okay, this extended transformation matrices, we need to extend the transform matrices to 3D and enable transformation of points by multiplication. Before we see how we don't have to look at that. We just need to see, not necessarily the part 3D multiplication, but transformation from a 2-dimension to a 3-dimension. For instance, if you have a point, let's say XY, remember in 2D we are drawing a column matrix as XY and 1. Now extending to 3D, we add the Z components, but we still have the one shown here, which is generically represented here. So this by itself is evident what we are talking about. We need to add the Z column. The Z coordinate. Then we also, when you're doing these transformations, a 2D is a 3x3 matrix, takes the form of a 3x3 matrix multiplication. 3D may take a 4x4 matrix multiplication, which you call homogeneous coordinates. So, as you can see here,
in the general form, of course. So if you have a translation matrix, then you have the translation factor Tx and Ty. In 3D, and this is how then it figures out to x, y, and then 1. Of course, the translation Tx, Ty, and then 1. I would say when you have 3 by 3, then we have 4 by 4 3D translation matrix, and you have the x, y, z coordinates as first just x and y. And this is how then we see the translation matrix and the factors Tx, Ty, Tz, and 1. That is it. That's how we do the at least from a matrices or vectors point of view. That is how we see it. And of course, this is repeated in scaling. When you have the scaling factor xx and sy, it means when you go to 3D, then you have x, sy, and sz. And of course, this will be a cube in 3D. So when you talk of scaling, of course, in 2D, we are talking of sy. In 3D, then we are talking of adding that sz scaling factor, as you can see here. So, and of course, the scaling function still takes the three parameters s, x, s, y, and s, z. Of course, you have OpenGL table leg. This is a diagram, just a core table leg. And then once you test it, you see that it has already defined some aspects which you may need. You may have had a lot of doing a lot of work for you to do. And here we have the rotation explained. So we've seen how the matrices now changes from 3 by 3 to 4 by 4. So that you can be able to save from here. We can now appreciate that we have these values for the z-axis. That is it. Those are the concepts which are there in with respect to 3D objects. I think I'm going to probably link you also to not just animation in 3D, but rather to 3D transformation, so that you can be able to appreciate how you create 3D objects using WebGL. It is available online, and we have the coordinates there being defined. And finally, also we have this cube which I would like you to view. And see, I provide this link anyway, I've done before. So thank you so much. I think you now have the materials you can use for revision. And if you have any question, feel free to WhatsApp. I will respond, or even we can use the forums if the lesson is going to have a forum. Thank you. Be blessed.